it's not necessarily the legal roads, like Ms. Gerhardt said. It's the illegal element, and I think that's what we're really more concerned about. So we know for a fact that this is draining our natural resources, i.e. water, and some of our electrical resources, sewer, things like that. And those are people that are illegal or who crowd down the sewer system. It's going to eventually end up raising our taxes and other unintended consequences. So because Colorado is quick to pass some of these amendments and laws, is Denver considering some kind of amendment to the amendment, if you will, about looking at the drain on resources and what it's doing to our state as a whole, but economically and things like that?
Not that I'm aware of. I mean, I have to go through the legislature, and I'm not aware of anything that's going through the legislature at this time.
Mind you, those are water-based things, so this is something that somebody's going to make a law for. Those are.
Well, what about education law? Because, I mean, those people that are going to be lawful are going to be lawful and they're going to be responsible citizens. What we're talking about is that you're responsible citizens.
Okay, I'll take a swing at that. Again, it's not about the lawful grows that any of us are concerned with. Our concerns are these rental properties that are rented by out-of-state tenants, like he was describing. Typically, Cuban nationals, there's a large number of them. They come in and make huge adjustments and changes to the home. They pump large amounts of water out of wells. They drain nutrients through the plants. They pump nutrients into the plants, and those drain out. And they typically drain into septic systems. And when you start pumping huge amounts of nutrients into septic systems, you're ruined. The grows in those septic systems are creating issues. And when they're done growing, they pack up and they leave. The reason that they're here is, again, back to the 99 plant rule. They can grow these plants unabated. They can pack them up and ship them to other states without being noticed in most cases. And they can move huge amounts of marijuana at low risk versus moving them from outside the country across the border and moving to them. And the quality of the marijuana that's being grown is considerably higher than what is grown outside the country. So what we're concerned with is those illegal grows. But at the same time, we have to respect the rights of the people who grow marijuana legitimately for a legitimate medical purpose. And we're okay with that. What we're trying not to do is cross the line, but hold that line as well. And it's a difficult, hazy position to be in.
Yeah, and I can appreciate what you're doing, but as a private citizen right now, I want to be a steward of our government's resources and do what I can do, but I also want to hold other folks to that same standard as well, and I want to make sure that we're not.
You should see the surprise on a homeowner's face when they believe that they have rented their home to a legitimate tenant, and they walk back in to see their home destroyed.
Right.
Destroyed. In many cases, uninhabitable. Mm-hmm. In many cases, hundreds of thousands of dollars of repairs that are not covered by insurance. And they do that because of the chasing the dream of big money to rent their property.
Got a question right here? It's a double-edged sword. You've got over 300 reports of growers illegally. I know I've talked to a sheriff's department for the past year, one next door, one five doors down, one across the street. They're still there, the same people. Tells me that perhaps you're understaffed, undermanned, to build a case, get the requirements to build a case to go and investigate it. Fair assumption? Or are you just going after the large fish first?
Can I say something to that? I don't think that's their assumption. How do you know that those rural operations aren't illegal?
It's in a residential neighborhood.
Well, we're in a
an upper middle class residential neighborhood.
That's all. Let's let him address. Let's let him address.
So, let me have just a second to address that. I'm going to throw you out some more numbers. Okay. As of May 31st, 2016, El Paso County had over 19,000 registered medical marijuana patients. We're the number one county in the state of Colorado for registered patients. We'll take, for instance, Pueblo. They've got, as of May 31st, I think it was 3,800. Registered patients, and that means that they have medical documentation to show that they're legally allowed to grow that amount of marijuana, whatever is on their recommendation per the state. Okay, so to kind of sum that up for you, I'm an investigator for Metro DNR. I'm the only one investigating marijuana currently in Colorado Springs, El Paso County, and Teller County. So with those numbers, when I go up to the door on a complaint, what do you think I'm going to get answered with? Here's my medical paperwork. And we go in and we verify the crime counts and we're going to have a nice day. Because they're legal under state law. So you can see where we're kind of in that dilemma of what's legal, what's not legal, pertaining to either state law, county ordinance, city ordinance, depending on which one, where we're at. So that's some of the issues that we are running into. It's not that we don't want to do anything, but they actually have legal paperwork under state law.
And you've already addressed how easy it is for anyone to spend $25 and go down and get their own car. So it's not a difficult process, and if you want to be able to go it legitimately or illegally, it doesn't take much to go down and get a car, and so then you're covered.
Absolutely correct, and like I said, we are the biggest, we have the most patients per the state of Colorado for license, or I should say license, but for registered.
I've got a gentleman that's in remission.
I'm in remission if I have enough access.
Good evening. My name is Candidate Tom Reynolds, Colorado House District 19 State Representative. This coming November election, I would just like to inform the citizens of my county, my district, to which I've lived in for the past 40 plus years in the county. There's going to be over 10 something resolutions on this coming November ballot about this very issue of the marijuana issue. And to echo what the young lady said right there in the blue sweater, the Democratic Party's we support pending legislation which allows for basically the federal regulation just basically says that we would like to turn the marijuana dispensaries back over to the American Native Indians. There's something that they've done all their life. There's something that they've started since forever. And the federal government feels that we should let them mine it for all it's worth. Thank you.
Any questions?
What is the state condone?
My question is for Sheriff Elder Dave Zorn, lifelong resident Dave. Also on the groundwater management district, these concerns have been with us since the passage of these amendments. We get concerns every day come in from people asking questions, wanting to know what they can and can't do. We've worked tirelessly with the state and the Groundwater Commission. I think that it all boils down to is that they want to hand it back down to the county, because these are the county's problems and the county needs to enforce these. I guess my question then comes back to what I'm hearing around here is, I was at the community meeting that was discussed where this was the topic of discussion. I guess my question is, if we have 19,000 some odd medical marijuana patients, Pueblo has 3,800, why is it that Pueblo is going after these grows, and they are prosecuting these grows with only 3,800 registered medical marijuana patients? There are 5 large-scale cartel grows within 1 mile on my road. Cuban cartel, Vietnamese cartel, Mexican cartel. These are not small grows. have turned them over. And I will give you, for instance, of a neighbor that is south of me. They showed up, your sheriff's department showed up, asked to see the grow. They were told no. They said, we'll be back in 10 days. You have 10 days to comply. You have a barn that has massive air conditioner units on it. You have another shop that glows like ET. You've got a basement of a 3,000 square foot home that glows. There's probable cause at the point, I feel, at which you know who they are. You know this is a grow. It's a matter of what is the grow, how many is the grow. So they walk away and tell them you have 10 days to comply. Comply with what? You don't even know what they have in them. So then 10 days goes by, still no repeat. They show back up, and the most they can do is fine them $100. That to me is not doing the community's protection when people and neighbors like the one south of me did, because he was concerned about what was going on with his property. I think there needs to be more teeth in this, and I think that was the biggest thing that came out of the Pueblo, out of the community meeting, was why Pueblo? What is the difference between Pueblo and El Paso County? I can tell you from the Upper Black Squirrel management standpoint, I've dealt with Lori Siegel, and so has our district. There are no licensed facilities in the Upper Black, which cover 350 square miles. There is no licensed facility. If they were, they would have been applications that would have come through the district where we would have had a chance to look at the water. So we know that all of these are that are being reported are more than likely not within the 6-plant or 12-plant limit. So I guess my question is why are we not enforcing these if you've got individuals who are concerned and are turning them in?
Let me make just a couple. Number one, Pueblo County is making arrests. They are conducting search warrants and seizures. They have not had a, unless you know something that I don't, right? They've not had a successful prosecution of any of them yet. Is that fair?
They've not had to challenge and conduct
an actual trial on them yet. That's the first thing. The second thing is they don't have a county ordinance that we do that we're trying to control that. So that'll help. But Sergeant Ray Gerhart met with the Pueblo County Sheriff's Office just recently, so you might as well address the difference.
Valid point. I saw what's going on in Pueblo, and myself and Adam and Doug talked to Sheriff Taylor. How you want to, what's going on? Sheriff Taylor's taking a really aggressive approach. And basically, what his approach is just because Amendment 20 and Amendment 64 passed, giving broader guidelines for the growth of marijuana, it did not decriminalize it under the 18 code, which is what Adam referenced earlier. So basically, what Sheriff Taylor does is, let's say you're allowed 24 plants. They get to your house one way or the other. You let them come in, whatnot. They have a county ordinance officer who's not a cop. If he comes out and says, you're 5 plants over, you need to get these 5 plants. If he comes back in 10 days, you say you can't come on my property, he turns it over to the sheriff's office. The sheriff's office will develop probable cause, like the district attorney's office reference. They will come, and they will execute that warrant if they get the judge to sign it. At that point, if you're all fresh 24 plants, but you have 29, they're going to take everything over 24 plants as evidence of a crime with an 18 code violation and arrest you. Seems pretty simple, right? The problem is, it's not so simple. As much as I love that aggressive approach, and I would really like to see that happen here, and we've been in negotiations with our staff about if this is feasible up here. If I come into your house and I take your plants, we're not going to take care of them. We're not going to put them in a greenhouse. We're not going to put them with lights and water. Typically, what we're going to do is cut. Another option is you can clip and sample. Well, that's like giving a person who stabs somebody the knife back. Okay, I took the blood off the knife. Here's your knife back. Have a good day. So what do? You've got to do something with that plant. So if you seize it, and then the plant dies, and you do not get a conviction, which is a big difference. Every case per Sheriff Taylor that's happened down in Pueblo County has fled out. The people who were arrested have accepted a plea. Sooner or later, somebody's going to take that to trial, and it's going to make some interesting case law, either down there or up here. Believe me, I know your pain as far as water usage. Most people out there are on a domestic exempt well. 20 people foot, which is roughly 3,000 to 4,000 gallons, for a home garden and or lawn. Per the Department of Natural Resources, that does not include a greenhouse, not for tomatoes, not for marijuana. As soon as you put a marijuana plant inside a greenhouse, it